So several years ago, when my daughter was only 3 or 4, I used to take her to conferences like this, and I would ask her to sit in the back and listen. So after a while, she gave me advice. She told me, "Mommy, don't ask the audience, can you hear me, because you are very loud and everybody can hear you. Instead, what you should ask is, can you see me, because you are too short behind the audience." So I hope you hear and see me. Okay. First, I want to introduce you to my institution, ICIPE, the International Center of Insect Physiology and Ecology. It's a center of excellence in Africa for research and capacity building. It was chartered and signed by 13 countries globally. It's more than 45 years old. It has currently about 450 staff from 35 nationalities of all continents, and between 100 and 150 graduate students, masters and PhD students annually come to ICIPE to do either part or all of their thesis at ICIPE. And they are registered in many different universities. On top of that, we have about 100 up to 150 also contracted workers, depending on our requirements. Everything we do also is done with partnership, many, many global partners we do for our both research and capacity building. So although we are based, our headquarters is in Kenya, Nairobi, beautiful Kenya, but we operate, we have activities in about 30 African countries, and as I said, with many collaborative global workers, partners. We also have branch offices in Ethiopia, in Uganda, and Tanzania, and we are considering to be also in Rwanda and the Democratic Republic of Congo. How we work? We work on what we call 4-H paradigms on human, animal, crop, and environmental health, and capacity building that cuts across all our programs. But always insects are our entry point, our common denominator, insects and arthropods. So often people ask me, why insects? A whole organization with multi-million dollar budget on tiny insects. So it's because of many, many different things that insects play in our lives. They play a significant role. They are everywhere in our environment. And without insects, our lives would be very different. We have insects that are predatory or parasitic on a number of harmful organisms. They are decomposers. They also a major role in food web. Birds and amphibians and a lot of wild animals and even people, they consume insects. So this, they also play a role in our food chain. But I think also what many people don't understand is also the role insects play, like bees and other pollinators, in food security. More than 70% of our food plants sources, they require bees or other pollinators for in one form or another. So but unfortunately also they play a role in transmitting diseases in crops, animals, and humans. And so for all these reasons, ICIPE is 100% focused on insects, and to the best of my knowledge, this is the only organization in the world that is focused on insects, 100%. So I want to give you a few examples of some of this, what we do. We do cutting-edge science. We publish in high-impact factors journals like Nature, like Science, but PNS, but that's not all we do. We translate those research outputs into impact to make a difference in people's lives. That's why donors give us some money. It's not to create a lucrative job for me, but really to translate that science and make a difference to the less fortunate ones. So let me give you a few examples. So I think yesterday, it was yesterday, the executive director, first she said about numbers and then forget about numbers. But we have to remember numbers, because unless I produce these numbers, the donors also would not give me the money to show how important it is, and also how, from this baseline, what we have done actually to reduce these numbers also. HESI flies, caused what they call African trypanosomiasis in humans and animals. So in of the 42 poorest countries in the world, 32 are in Africa, and this have HESI flies. There was a recent article that came from Berkeley that shows that states that in fact, the critical development challenge and cause, poor development cause in Africa is HESI fly. So I think it would not be, that statement is not far from the truth. So they are spread over 9 million square kilometers of land, and a number of also cattle, sheep, and goats are affected. And the economic loss in terms of meat, milk, and so on is significant. And so these are the areas also you can see which is affected by HESI flies. So some years ago, ICIPE scientists noticed that the wildlife in Kenya, water bugs and zebras, they can live in heavily infested HESI fly areas without being affected, in areas where cattle cannot survive. So through many years of experiment, they identified five chemicals that are actually exuded by water bug and that are repellent to the HESI flies. That is the reason why these animals can live without being affected by HESI flies, but cattle cannot. So again, through a series of work in chemistry, we identified the chemical structure. We defined the chemical structure of these chemicals. We could synthesize them in the lab. And we designed a collar system, like a, almost like similar to what dog flea thing, to put to imitate the water bugs and zebras and so on. And this is very effective. It works. It works beautifully. But then you can see Masa is here. Actually, they got very smart. They noticed in our experimental, large experimental plots that the animals that have these collars are protected, so they bring their animals to graze their animals next to the ones with collars, but they don't, they are not stealing the collars. Huh? So, and it works well, but these flies have to go somewhere once it is repelled. So we designed then a trapping system that is based on color. The flies are attracted to certain color. To blue color, they land into the black one, they go up into the light plastic, they are trapped and they die. But also, then we put also here down, you can see urine, animal urine to attract them, olfactory senses also. So what also we found that buffalo urine is much more effective, but it's very difficult to attract a buffalo urine from on a continuous basis. But this works very nicely. The pastoralists can wrap these traps, they can move, these are also, they can move. But the problem is how to scale it out. Scaling out is always a problem when you translate research into impact. So we are still struggling with this. And finally, we got a company that is based in Germany that is now designing the collar in a cheaper way, and it was a company in Kenya that was producing, but it cannot produce more than a few hundred at a time, And the cattle, millions of cattle in Africa, they need this. So that's where we are now, to produce that. And then once this is designed out of plastic, we have also to find a company that will mass produce it for business, but in a more effective way. So this is widely in demand, but unless we scale it out, it is difficult. And if you keep with the collar 75% of your herd, the rest is protected. So it's a very, very effective mechanism. So recently, last year also, that in collaboration with a number of organizations led by Yale University, and we are significant partners in this, the entire genome of the sayfly was also sequenced and published in Science. Although that sequence data doesn't bring immediate solution, it is good to understand the enemy. It's good to know the flies better. So I think a number of tools can be developed out of this. We are positive about that. So we are working with global partners on this. The next is malaria that we work on. I think all of you know. These little mosquitoes that transmit all these diseases, including malaria, they have killed more people than all the global conflicts combined together. So this is really critical, extremely critical in Africa. Children are more vulnerable, below five. There has been significant improvement and reduction in the malarial deaths because of the indoor insecticide embedded nets. But the mosquitoes are smart. They have developed a strategy. So they developed, they shift, and they bite outdoor instead of indoor now. So this is a critical area that ICIPE is focused on. And our approach work on integrated vector management systems, not just insecticide, just not on one technology, but overall understanding the enemy, the mosquito, and developing a system how to manage in a more integrated way. So this, for example, this is work done last year and published. So we found out that infected mosquitoes, they are attracted to certain sugars. They require that sugar to sustain them. And these sugars come from native plants that are weeds that are in all the gardens of people and so on. So one, I think, was this knowledge can make us do either a attractant system out of these sugars, or also managing these plants also can control the mosquitoes. This is one. This was published in Current Biology last year, and it was highlighted in Nature. This is again the first discovery of a certain type of sugars being a key attractant to infected mosquitoes. We work also very interesting work also, discoveries done also on spiders, jumping spiders that feed on mosquitoes, but not just any mosquitoes, but blood-containing mosquitoes. This was done in our station in off the shore of Victoria, Lake Victoria, and it's very, very fascinating spider that's particularly attracted to human blood. And so both odors of humans and the mosquitoes, they that are fed with human blood, they attract this spider, and it feeds on specifically these spiders. Another type of spider is also has been discovered also by ICIPE scientists, and this, in addition to insect mosquitoes, it feeds also preys on larvae and pupae of mosquitoes. While we are not intending to multiply these spiders and invade the whole place, what we have discovered also is that these spiders they survive also on certain type of plant sugars. So when they have that plant sugar, that makes them a more effective predator. So overall, I think maintaining those plants, conservation, and so on would create a more integral way of managing mosquitoes and malaria by extension. This year, a new discovery was also in the soils of certain soils in Lake Victoria area, which is a malaria-prone area. Cedrol is produced, and cedrol, a chemical cedrol, that attracts pregnant mosquitoes and traps them before they lay their eggs. So all these discoveries come together to manage mosquitoes in a more integrated way. Another area that we have also started last year, a program on Indus imbalances. All of us, we are walking microbes, basically. We have, our body has a variety of Indus imbalances, endophytes. Many living organisms have that. That also contribute to, generally, to our well-being. And insects are not different, so we have started a program on this, and we are having exciting results on malaria-transmitting mosquitoes that we have discovered new spiroplasmas that survive in insects and we have in malaria, mosquito-transmitting malaria. And what we found out is preliminary data is that this spiroplasma containing mosquitoes are not able to transmit the malaria parasite. So this has significant implication in managing malaria. But we are not able to, so far, to culture this or to establish colonies or to transmit them into other mosquitoes, but we are working on that. Last year, some group has discovered, and it was published in Science in Burkina Faso, an endosymbiont called Wolbachia. And we have also identified this this year in malaria-transmitting mosquitoes. So all this combined would have a significant impact in managing malaria. Another exciting to switch to plants, another switch exciting technology developed by ICIPE and its partners is a management of striga, a parasitic weed, which is literally robbing livelihood from farmers and people in sub-Saharan Africa. This is a very, very bad parasitic weed, which doesn't have any control mechanism until this technology came to life. And it is also a parasite that affects all cereals, sorghum, maize, millet, rice, every staple crop that Africa depends on. And as I think many of you know, a lot of the back-breaking work in Africa is reserved for women. The weeding, the collecting of firewood, the collecting of feed for animals, and so on. So I am particularly, personally, also committed to finding solutions that will alleviate the hardship on women, because I have lived that in the rural Ethiopia when I grew up. So weeding is really a bad, bad task, and it's 100% done by women. So this was an accidental discovery in an attempt to solve the problem with on stem borer. Accidentally, then scientists at ICIPE discovered that actually the method of controlling the pest was also effective in controlling this striga. This purple flower, that is striga, the parasitic weed. You can see all these women bending down to try to hand weed, but by then it's already, the crop is gone already, it's too late. So just imagine how many of us can actually bend the whole day doing this work. And you can see also here women, some are collecting water, some are gathering here firewood, some are for animal feed. These all women doing all this. So this is a magical plant called Desmodium here. It's a legume, a forage legume. It's high quality animal feed. It fixes nitrogen up to 160 kilograms per hectare into the soil. It also controls this striga. And so, and two types of that. So I will save you with all the chemistry, a lot of chemistry we did together with partners in UK to determine what actually this does. So what it does, so you can see here, together with some other legume, cowpea, it doesn't control. In the presence of this Desmodium, 100% control of the parasitic weed. Rice, the same thing. Here you see the parasitic weed. Here is free in the presence of Desmodium. We have also, in a long-term experiment, we have shown also that if we continuously grow this Desmodium, that it, we can deplete the striga weed from the soil completely. So these striga weeds, they produce tons of minute seeds into the soil, and it can survive, they can survive up to 20, 30 years. So once the soil is infected, it's not usable for any cereal production. So, but this is a black and white, beautiful technology. So we can completely cure the soil within 5 years of continuous growth of this. And also, I want you to also see that it's not just striga. It suppresses all other weeds also. So it is completely freeing women from doing the weeding, and very healthy crop, free nitrogen, and animal feed. So it's a beautiful technology. So the other, I think, work we do is on bees. I have indicated bees are extremely important. North America and Europe is facing what is called colony collapse syndrome. I think I am convinced that we are going to bring you a solution for your problem as well. So not just us. So we have a pipeline products. We produce a lot of products that are effective in curing some of the causes, suspected causes of colony collapse. For example, varroa mites are suspected as a cause of this. And last year we just opened a brand new reference laboratory for Africa on bee health. This whole entire lab is for bee health. So with my determination to really bring solution for women, again, last year we started a program on insects for food and feed. Traditionally, many African countries, Africans consume insects. That's a good source of protein. And Asia is mainstreamed, particularly in Thailand, insects for food and feed. A number of our chicken that are roaming around in the garden as organic chicken, actually they consume, that's what they look for in the garden, is in the field, is insects. So we have started that program. We did inventory of African edible insects, and that paper is published, and you can see all these darker areas as where insects are heavily consumed in Africa. More than 500 species, about 30% of the world's global list of edible insects have been documented. So we have also, traditionally also, then women and children are tasked with this, with collecting from the forest, and they have many different ways of gathering them. I have seen also farmers making noise, music to attract termites, for example. But It has many, many technologies also of trapping insects for experimental purposes that we can make that available. However, also over fishing, over harvesting in the wild may not be good for the ecosystem. So, and you can see again, women drying what they have collected, the insects they have collected from the forest. Once they dry them, some of them they consume for their family. With their families, some they sell them. So ICIPE has more than 40 years of experience in arthropod mass rearing. We have protocols of more than 100 species of insects. And these are some of the examples of what we do per week for experimental purposes. So why not then we convert this into protocol to mass rear insects? For consumption. That is the whole idea of the program. But I think insects are not just only for food, but they have also a health value. This is a paper just last month published, and that shows that desert locust has actually benefit, health benefit. And you can see the nutrition value compared of locusts compared to beef and fish is pretty good, high quality. You can see also that in this paper what we demonstrated also is that desert locusts can consume, this is a very, very voracious pest. They can consume a whole field, green plants, but they can then manufacture 20-40% fold of what they consume into very beneficial sterols that have benefits for cardio and reduction of cardiovascular risk. I think the first day, yesterday, there was a presentation on that. Yeah. So here, for example, this is one of the products of sterol that are commercially available for treating high levels of cholesterol. But what we are saying is that if you have insects incorporated into your main food source, the risk can be significantly reduced. So once this was published, a lot of journalists came to us, including CNN, NPR, National Geographic, and they requested that we also prepare meal in our cafeteria, that we did. And you see that I haven't tested it, but this is my director of research. He was eating it, and everybody else is eating it. So they say it's good. It tastes like shrimp, so it must be. So I think I hope you see we have also a lot of data on insects on as sources of antioxidants and other health effects. So we hope that this actually will be mainstreamed insects for food. Capacity building is our main component of work. So this is a 2015 figure. We have 68 PhD, 56 masters, and 16 postdocs. About 40% of these are women. And I want to also note that about 50% of our high quality publications and high impact factor, they are generated by graduate students. So they are a very good component of our workforce. You know, many of you are in academia. That's a cheap labor force and high quality labor force. So, but we believe in capacity building, particularly for Africa. The difference between Kenya or Ethiopia or any other African country and US is not really anything else but capacity when it comes down to it. Capacity to invent, capacity to innovate, capacity to absorb new technologies, and so on. So unless capacity in every sector is enhanced, I don't believe that Africa would develop. And we have to do that at a much, much accelerated rate than what's happening. We generate a lot of our also results and translate research outputs in partnership with the private sector. So some of this is an example is biopesticides. We produce quite a few biopesticides, and the private sector, for example, here is a Kenyan-based private sector called Real IPM. They formulate this, they work with us in partnership, they generate products, they register in different countries, and they sell, and they pay a certain portion of the sales to back to us into the research. And you can see here some of our products for various insect management. Here you can see they are registered and sold in these places. It's being now registered here, being registered in Canada, in the European Union, and in Asia. So when I say that we will bring a solution to the bee problem, that's not an stretch. We are bringing solution to other parts of the world in crop pests. Here you see you have also tick problems here, and tick is a global issue. We have also a biopesticide which is now here. The container is already made, ready to go, but not registered yet here. So again, sticks also. This is also one of the technologies engineered by ICIPE scientists, but taken up by the private sector here. An attractant, insect attractant, is embedded here. But the insects are lured here, and then inside is a fungal bioentomopathogen embedded here. So the insects go here, they are coated with the fungal spore, and they go out. So they self-spread that entomopathogen. So this is working extremely well and sold by this company, Real IPM. Now a company, really IPM UK, is being established in UK, trying to buy this also, but I don't know, that's not my business, how they acquire or they do, as long as our product reaches people and makes a difference, yeah. These are some of the ICIPE products over the years, just some, not all. I was yesterday at Walgreens. And I was thinking, why don't they carry some of our products, actually? Because a lot of these are also completely 100% plant products, and they are very effective. They are non-toxic, mosquito, tick, whatever, repellent. I think this will be very useful. This is a product, larvicide or against mosquitoes and so on. So we have a number of others in the pipeline. We have a number of patents, including this year. Last year we patented an antibiotic that is effective against hospital bugs that are resistant to normal antibiotics. And that was isolated from a nematode, an African nematode gut. So we have a lot of stuff, I think we do. Again, I was listening to the presenter from the Harris Group yesterday, so I was thinking, boy, we have a lot of this, so why don't you? So, yeah. All this is possible in addition to our global partners by many of our donors. A lot of our money comes from European governments, Germany, UK, the Kenyan government also is a core donor for us, in addition to all the land and the resources they give us. Sweden and Switzerland, these are core donors that give us money annually to pay for the research, not only the research salary and so on, but also to pay for infrastructure and so on. But we get that is about 40% of our total budget. The rest is project funding, which comes from many different organizations. So for the first time, and last year we brought in 11 new donors, and for the first time also we became the direct grantee of NIH. In the past it was us subcontracted by US or European organizations. Now I think NIH even saw that we are actually very first quality organization. So our PI is a Kenyan scientist, so we became a direct grantee. So 11 new donors is a good size for 1 year. So we want to diversify our funding portfolio so that we do a lot more work than we are doing now. As a whole, I think ICIPE, I hope I showed you that ICIPE is a very impactful organization. We have reached many, many thousands of farmers and people, and I hope also you'd be interested in partnering with us. Thank you.
That was a really great talk. I just had a question just for my own curiosity related to the mosquito work, because as many people here know, in the US, the big thing has, of course, been West Nile, but also dengue fever and chikungunya, which is coming up from the Caribbean, and everyone's worried that on their tropical vacations, they're gonna have an issue. And I was reading an article in NPR the other day about some genetically modified mosquitoes that they're thinking of releasing in Florida, and that basically would breed with the mosquitoes that carry chikungunya and dengue, and then they would die, but they're infertile. So, and they were doing a lot of work on the kind of the public, whether the public would accept something like that. So I was curious if there are any technologies like that that were sort of being investigated in Africa and in your institute.
Yeah. So I just gave you only a very fraction of what we do. There is a project that we are working with on funded by the Gates Foundation together with the Imperial College in the UK on that. A GM mosquito, sterile mosquito, basically. But the GM technology, as you know, it's controversial. But also the release of any GM is not ICIPE's responsibility. It's up to the individual country governments. For example, if this mosquito is to be released in Kenya, it is a Kenyan government. My colleague from the National Biosafety Authority, and so on. Those are the people who do. We provide the technology, we provide the science, scientific background and information, the fact and so on. Then it is really their responsibility to reject it or to release it, as he has described yesterday, and in other places as well. There is work also on tsetse flies with irradiation. Technology with radiation to make them sterile, which has been going on for a long time. I don't think it was very, very effective, but so that is also going on. But that is an NGM technology, and that has been released many times in there. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you for that inspiring talk. I was just wondering, in terms of the tsetse fly and your water bug repellent, in the same way that you kind of see with antibiotics driving evolution of bacteria, whether depriving the tsetse fly of their food source by putting this repellent on is likely to drive evolution within the insect population and lead perhaps to resistant strains that could lead to a public health hazard in the future for both for the water bug and the human population.
I'm not sure whether I understood your question. You are asking me whether we do some other thing to make the tsetse flies less competitive, or
if you use an antibiotic against a population of bacteria, you can get growth of those that have developed a genotype that allows them to be resistant to that antibiotic. And whether the same could happen with these tsetse flies, that if you deprive them of their food source, you drive the development of strains which have a genetic resistance to this repellent you're using.
And
so basically it becomes infected, and you're left with after a few years of use, you're left with the same problem again and need to find something else and some other work going forward?
That's an excellent question. That can happen. However, maybe the water bug evolutionary has developed that, making sure that it's a blend of five chemicals. So making sure that actually the resistance doesn't develop. If it develops against one, it doesn't develop against the other one. So this is a blend of five. And I think probably naturally, evolutionary, the water bug still is intact, maybe because of that composition, yeah. Yeah. So it's a blend of five, yes. It's a little bit more difficult for the pest, for the insect to overcome that. Five mixtures, maybe that's why it is, yeah. But we are working also, what I haven't said also is that we are working on also microbes that live in within the SSA fly. And there is indication that some of these microbes make the SSA flies more competitive, more fit. So maybe manipulation of those could also in the long run help us to reduce the SSA fly population. Yeah.
My turn? Is it my turn? Yes, sorry. I am very much excited to hear your talk today. I have been following your work for a long time, and the reason why I was following your work for a long time is, first of all, I'm also an Ethiopian, and I idolize you. I wanted my daughter to come and meet you today, but she had an internship, so she couldn't come in and talk to you, but I hope you are going to be in the Washington, D.C. area so that I can meet with you.
Thank you.
Secondly, I am an African who has lived in this country for a long time, but Africa has never left my head. I go back and visit Africa many times, and I was raised in a very rural part of Ethiopia, where I actually had a Tarzan moment when I was growing up. But when I went back to, I always go back to Ethiopia every year to see my mother, I am saddened by the decimation of insects in an area where I was born and raised. In other words, because of the population growth and also because of uncontrolled use of insecticides, pesticides, all of those insects that I knew are literally gone. It's not only the vertebrae that are gone, but all of those insects are gone. Now, the question I have for you is that, given that insects play a big role in, for example, the honeybee story in the US is a typical example. Insects play a big role also in Africa. For instance, my dad used to grow coffee, and coffee is unimaginable where I grow up now, because I suspect it may be because of the decimation of insects, but you may not be right. But the question I have for you is that, is there any research that you are doing to do some conservation of these insects? For example, do you have an insect bank? Because most of those species, I don't think are gonna come back, first of all. So, my question is,
what do you do
research in that aspect?
Okay, thank you. Good question. Yes, definitely. Our bee health work, for example, is really working with us with forest conservation. And I think the best way to conserve anything is to make use of it. So when we show farmers that actually by conserving instead of cutting the trees and making charcoal to sell, that if we give them the technology to raise to produce honey and the way to also make a livelihood out of the honey production is, and wax production and many different things which go with it, is to conserve the trees. And it is working very well in Kenya. We have just started, it has been going on for a few years in Ethiopia. We have domesticated the stingless bee. Stingless bee honey is extremely important, medicinal, has medicinal value. It has high demand all across Africa, particularly in Ethiopia. So farmers used to follow this tiny stingless bee, follow the bee all day long to see where that bee goes into the soil to extract that. So we have domesticated that, established colonies, designed hive specific for that, and that's working also. For that is an incentive to give incentive for conservation, basically. And so, yes, we work with a number of conservation agencies, but to help make a living out of this. Otherwise, if they don't see any advantage to it, they are not going to conserve. So through bees, we are also conserving those. Yeah. We have just also published 13 new species of insects and predators that have never been described in Kenya and Burundi. That was just out also a week ago also. So again, showing the valuable impact of these insects and educating the people would encourage also that conservation. Thank you.
I think there was another element to the question, which was about ultimately indiscriminate use of pesticides, insecticides. I mean, I imagine regulation is well outside your remit, but
yeah.
Can you say a little bit about that?
Because yeah.
Particularly since insects are a food source, is there a risk associated with that? Or?
Yeah, absolutely, there is a risk. But I think, for example, let me give an example in Kenya where we know we work closely with the government. Kenya, for example, recently they has been given a warning from the European Union because of the residual pesticide of the vegetable produce that is exported into Europe. So this is also an incentive for governments also to do a better regulation and monitoring to reduce that indiscriminate use of pesticides also. So, and I think because of that probably also is that our biopesticides are getting a lot of demand, because they leave no residue and they don't have any toxicity to people, yeah. But again, I think for regulation and so on, I think data like this, providing data technical support is the key to in reduction of pesticide use. It's not just a residue, but also it contaminates water sources, it contaminates a lot of different things.
Yeah.